Thank you, George, very much indeed. Gary has asked me to be very brief in my introduction because he has lots of material. This is because, being both of us spatial creatures rather than musical notes, this is a zero-sum game. So the more introduction you get, the less lecture you get. So let me just say that Gary is chaplain at University of King's College in Halifax, Nova Scotia. He learned theology under Andrew Lath, and he's speaking today on Cyril, John of Damascus, and Richard Crooker's Doctrine of the Trinity. So will you please welcome Gary Thorne?
Before I begin, I want to show three slides very quickly. I suspect there might only be one of you that for whom one of these three slides will be helpful, but for that one person, Richard Hooker, Laws of Ecclesiastical Polity, defense in 8 books of the Church of England after the Elizabethan settlement, Act of Supremacy, 1558, and Act of Uniformity, 1559. Book 5 is a commentary, a defense on the prayer book, 1559. And in the middle of Book 5, chapters 50 to 68, is his presentation on the sacraments. The first 6 chapters there, chapters 50 to 55, is his treatment of the Trinity and the Incarnation, or Christology, that prefaces his actual description of the sacraments of baptism and Holy Communion, chapters 57 to 68, and the bridge chapter is Book 5, chapter 56. If you don't know the dates of these three people, I will not be, you should take note of them now. Cyril of Alexandria, Theodoret, and Theodoret's work that I will be mentioning is the Ernestes, or the Three Dialogues. John of Damascus, these are his dates, and the work that I'll be referring to is De Fide Orthodoxa, which is the ingathering or the summary of patristic teaching. And for, there might not be one of you even that would need to know any of this, but Cassin, Two Natures in One Person, Eutyches, heretic for this reason, One Nature After the Union, Nestorius, heretic for this reason, Two Natures in Two Persons After the Union, and the Communicatio Idiomatum, which means only, it refers to the interaction of the properties, the attributes of the divine and human natures of Christ. So, I apologize if not, if there wasn't one of you that needed to know any of that. I'm afraid I'm speaking very much from my local context in Eastern Canada, and about the practical evangelism of young persons through the liturgy of the church. As a university chaplain in Canada, I observe that the majority of secular students who arrive on campus each year have an intuition and perhaps an experience of transcendence that enriches the natural world and human communities. Unlike their previous generation, who currently govern the university as administrators, staff, and faculty, and who hold on to a rather sterile definition of secularity simply as the absence of God, these young people who are showing up these days seek to discover a deeper transcendence in the created order and human community than they perceive institutional religion to have on offer. They seek a world enchanted, or perhaps re-enchanted, with wonder and transcendence. I believe that Richard Hooker's notion of law describes just such a world, and that Hooker proposes that the way to discover this enchanted world is through a proper understanding of the Trinitarian character of the natural order discovered through participation in the Christian sacraments. It is regularly noted that the concept of participation is the theme that holds together the entirety of Richard Hooker's theology from Book 1 to Book 8 of the Polity. One critical discussion of participation occurs in Book 5 as part of Hooker's commentary on the sacraments and baptism and the Eucharist as found in the 1559 Book of Common Prayer. And there Hooker makes clear that Trinitarian and Christological theology, outlined in Laws, Chapter 5, Chapters 50 to 55, provides the key to an understanding of the sacraments. Laws, Chapter 56, has been called the theological heart of Book 5, and thus of the entire Laws, and it is the hinge that sums up the consideration of the Trinitarian and Christological theology in chapters 51 to 55, and introduces the discussion of the sacraments proper. Hooker begins this bridge chapter, Laws 5:56, by summing up the notion of how Christ is in us. The argument of Laws chapter 5, chapters 51 to 55, in terms of participation. He says, we have hitherto spoken of the person and of the presence of Christ. Participation is that mutual inward whole which Christ hath of us and we of him, in such sort that each possesseth other by way of special interest, property, and inherent copulation. Hooker then reviews the overall argument of the Laws in terms of participation. He recollects his teaching from Book 1 that law is to be discovered in the nature of God, the Trinity. Quote, the being of God is a kind of law to his own working. For that perfection which God is, giveth perfection to what he doth. This first eternal law, which governs God in himself in saying, is like unto the second eternal law that governs all created reality and extra. All law reflects the following principles. Every original cause imparted itself unto those things which come of it, and whatsoever taketh being from any other, the same is after a sort in that which giveth it being. These, many of you will know, this comes directly from the 6th century Dionysius, who in turn was simply explicating Christian terms the thinking of his near contemporary Proclus. Every effect remains in its cause, proceeds from it, and reverts upon it. These universal principles of knowing and being necessarily determine and limit our ability to say anything of the mysteries of the Trinity and the Incarnation, but they also make clear that our knowing and being is dependent throughout on a notion of participation that runs through all reality, both created and uncreated. And in this chapter, Hooker outlines his intent to describe the various types and degrees of participation within the Trinity itself, between the two natures of Christ in the Incarnation, and between the created order and God the Trinity, both as Creator and as Savior. All things participate in God the Trinity through the natural law. All things are therefore partakers of God. They are his offspring. His influence is in them. And the personal wisdom of God is for that very cause said to reach unto everything which is. Whatsoever God doth work, the hands of all three persons are jointly and equally in it, according to that, to the order of that connection, whereby they each depend upon other. The Father is goodness, the Son is witness, wisdom, the Holy Ghost is power, do all concur in every particular outwardly issuing from that one only glorious deity, which they all are. so that all things which God hath made are in that respect the offspring of God. They are in him as effects, as in their highest cause. He likewise actually is in them the assistance and influence of his deity, is their life. The final desire of God is of man is God. And since desire tendeth unto union with that it desireth, union with God, return unto our highest cause is our happiness. If then we be blessed, it is by force of participation and conjunction with him, God. Then we are happy, therefore, when fully we enjoy God. Though we be men, yet by being unto God united, we live, as it were, the life of God. But by sin of pride, man's reason is corrupted so that our knowledge of good and evil is confused, and thus return of the effect unto the cause is desired but unattainable. In the incarnation, Christ makes the ascent possible again because he is, as Hooker says, quote, he is in us as a moving and a working cause, Jesus Christ. Humankind's return to God and participation in God the Trinity is restored by supernatural grace in the divine law. These were in God as in their Savior and not as in their Creator only. It was the purpose of his saving goodness, his saving wisdom, and his saving power, which inclined itself towards them. Life, as in all other gifts and benefits, groweth originally from the Father and cometh not to us but by the Son, nor by the Son to any of us in particular, but through the Spirit, which three, St. Peter comprehended in one, the participation of divine nature. Thus, in broadest terms, outlined in Laws 5:56, all creatures participate in God through following the laws of their nature. Thus, our secular students who come to university somehow know this. The law of man's nature is that he desires the good, but in fact he cannot will the good, and his return to God is frustrated. Christ has come to be the new law, the divine law, that makes it possible for man to obtain by degrees the highest good which he seeks, and thus to live the life of God. Hooker says, finally, since God has deified our nature, though not by turning it into himself, yet by making it his own inseparable habitation, we cannot now conceive how God should, without man, either exercise divine power or receive the glory of divine praise, for man is in both an associate of deity. And in subsequent chapters, Hooker will proceed to describe the sacraments, baptism, and the Eucharist as the means by which, by participation, by degrees, we grow in holiness and virtue. Well, that's the overall argument, too briefly considered. But since our theme is that of knowing and loving the Triune God, let's return to the beginning of Hooker's commentary on the sacraments as they appear in the Book of Common Prayer, where he argues that an understanding of the sacraments depends directly on the doctrine of the Trinity and Incarnation. In Laws 5:50, as this section begins, Hooker describes the sacraments as powerful instruments of God to eternal life, and the means whereby humans are made partakers of God in Christ, in these very much quoted words. For as our natural life consisteth in the union of the body with the soul, so our life supernatural in the union of the soul with God. And for as much as there is no union of God with man without the mean between both, which is both, it seemeth requisite that we first consider how God is in Christ, then how Christ is in us, and how the sacraments so serve to make us partakers with Christ. In other things we may be more brief, but the weight of these require largeness. While generally speaking, This scheme is unexceptional. Hooker will rehearse several times how the First Council of Nicaea insisted that the Son was not in the Father simply by an undefined participation, but that the Son shared the same uncreated divine essence as the Father. And subsequent councils of the Chalcedon describes how the Eternal Word, Son of God, assumed human nature, so that through an unconfused yet indivisible union, the divine and human natures defined by communicatio idiomatum, this human nature became deified human nature in the Son. In baptism and the Eucharist, we participate in Christ's deified humanity, and thus we become partakers with Christ of the divine life of the Trinity. Although this scheme is commonplace, Hooker's selection of sources and authorities in Laws 5, chapter 50-56, is what interests me. In Hooker's 852 patristic references throughout the Laws, the Latin Fathers predominate, of course, yet in these chapters, Theodore of Cyrus, Cyril of Alexandria, and John of Damascus are prominent, and in these chapters, there are only six medieval and no classical or contemporary references. That Hooker privileges these three Greek authors is unquestionable from any plain reading of the text. And it is natural to ask why Hooker determines these three particular Greek authors to be authoritative in establishing the Trinitarian and Christological theology that best explains the nature of the sacraments in the Book of Common Prayer. Some bits of the answer to this question are well established, even often overlooked by scholars. For example, Hooker is entirely in step with 16th century magisterial reformers in their humanist cry of ad fontes. Back to the sources. The general response of the magisterial reformers to the scholastic arguments over the localized presence of Christ in the Eucharist was to turn to an earlier Greek patristic Christology as the key to understanding the nature of the presence of Christ in the Eucharist. The early reformers then discovered that in the pre-scholastic Greek patristic tradition, Eucharistic theology was directly and intimately connected with Trinitarian and Christological doctrine. Melanchthon in 1526. The Greek doctrine of the Lord's Supper holds that the real presence of the Eucharistic Christ is analogous to the mode of being of the historical Christ. The Greeks understood the presence of the body of Christ as an anamnesis of the Incarnation, and the Eucharist itself as an anamnesis of the whole Christ event. Thus, the doctrine of the Eucharist recapitulates the doctrine of the person of Christ. Secondly, that Hooker should highlight Theodore of Cyrus in his doctrinal introduction to the sacraments is to be expected. Theodore had been introduced to the English context by Peter Martyr when he arrived in England in 1547 with a fresh copy of Theodore's Aramistes, or Three Dialogues, and it's likely that Cranmer borrowed exactly this copy from Peter Martyr in composing his 1550 Defense of the True Catholic Doctrine of the Sacrament of the Body and Blood of Christ. And in his response to the defense, Stephen Gardiner engaged both Peter Martyr and Thomas Cranmer over their interpretation of Theodore's theology. But thereafter, the point is, Theodore's Three Dialogues became a central text in the continuing Eucharistic controversies in England in the 16th century. As Marvin Anderson rightly suggests, the Christological observations in this ancient Greek treatise became integral to the Tudor Reformation at a critical juncture. What remains to be explained, however, are Hooker's references to John of Damascus, and particularly his extended use of Cyril of Alexandria. The main argument of this paper is that in these central chapters of the Laws, Hooker specifically leans upon the theology of Cyril of Alexandria determining influence on his interpretation of the sacraments and the prayer tradition. And although I think Hooker could not be more direct in pointing to Cyril's theology, simply read the text, commentators on Hooker have not acknowledged this dependence sufficiently. First, a very brief excursus to Hooker's use of the De Fide Orthodoxa of John of Damascus, which will help set the context for Cyril's contribution. In Laws 551, Hooker begins his argument of how God is in Christ by reminding us that the statement, "The Lord our God is but one God," refers to the indivisible unity of God. Hooker is bringing to mind his discussion in Book 1, where he says, God is one, or rather very oneness and mere unity, having nothing but itself in itself, and not consisting, as all things do beside God, of many things. Nonetheless, says Hooker, we adore that indivisible unity as Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the Father being of none, the consubstantial Word, which is the Son, is of the Father, and of the co-essential Holy Ghost proceeding from both. The persons of the Trinity share one substance, but in each there is also, quote, that property which causeth the same person really and truly to differ from the other two. Each person of the Trinity has its own subsistence because of the uniqueness of origin. And thus, when God became man, it was not the Father nor the Holy Spirit, but only the Son or the Word that was made flesh. Well, in this introductory chapter to his Trinitarian Christological doctrine, Hooker turns to John of Damascus to support his summary of how God is in Christ in the Incarnation. In De Fide Orthodoxa, as the Damascene moves to consider the revealed theologia and soikonomia, the Trinity and the Incarnation, he quotes the dictum of a Gregory theologian, which Hooker would acknowledge to be the principle that guides all of Christological doctrine, and which will encourage him to turn to Cyril. Christ in his entirety assumed me in my entirety, and was wholly united to the whole, so that he might bestow the grace of salvation upon the whole. For that which has not been assumed cannot be healed. Although Hooker's several summaries of the ecumenical councils in these chapters always conclude with Chalcedon in 451, and he asserts that all errors of Christology can be reduced to one of the four principal heresies refuted in the four most ancient councils. In turning to John of Damascus, what does he do? He acknowledges that there was continued debate after Chalcedon about just how this individual person, Jesus Christ, could be both of and in the two natures of divinity and humanity. John of Damascus, De Fide, is a recapitulation and resolution of 3 centuries of debate among various groups of Neo-Chalcedonians, historians, and monophysites over the definitions of the notions of ousia, ousis, hypostasis, and prosopon. And thus Hooker's first quotation acknowledges this history in presenting John's definition. Hypostasis is that which is common, along with that which is individuating. Ousia does not subsist in itself, but is to be perceived, contemplated in individuals. And this is the first quote of Hooker. This is the second quote of Hooker from John of Damascus, in which the Damascene, I have not incidentally, quotes Dionysius the Areopagite, Hooker's chief source in his general philosophy of law, or Lex Divinitatis. Father and the Holy Ghost have no communion with the Incarnation of the Word otherwise than by approbation and assent. But it's most interesting, and what I want to point to, is Hooker's third passage from John of Damascus, where he points to John's notion of perichoresis. I think this notion has been brought up several times in their conference already. But it's only in the Damascene that we have this notion gathered up in such a way that it reconciles the various strands of Christological thinking after Chalcedon, as it roots back in Gregory the Theologian and in the New Testament, as we heard this morning. In the section of De Vita to which Hooker refers, John promotes the term perichoresis as adequate, and this is what is unique in John, as adequate both to Trinitarian and Christological doctrine, in describing a type of mutual indwelling or immanence that protects the identity and difference of the persons of the Trinity on the one hand, and of the divine and human natures of Christ on the other. In Hooker's consideration of the communicatio idiomatum, he cautions that the union must not be seen, quote, as any mutual participation whereby the properties of the one are infused into the other, but rather, the notion of perichoresis serves to protect the asymmetry of the union, allowing the divine nature to take the initiative and essentially to remain unaffected by that which it indwells or pervades. As Hooker says, quote, the union doth add perfection to the weaker, to the nobler, no alteration at all. And this is what Hooker refers to. Such then is the manner of this exchange by which each nature communicates its own properties to the other through the identity of their person and their mutual immanence. Thus, Hooker learns from John of Damascus that the notion of perichoresis, or mutual indwelling, is adequate to how God is in Christ, theologia, and how Christ is in us, oikonomen. We also note that in this section of John's De Vita, which Hooker has before him, John quotes Cyril more than any other author. More significantly, John alludes to Cyril's controversy with Theodoric over theopaschalism, the notion of heresy that God suffers in himself. But we shall now see that this controversy, this becomes an important theme in Hooker's understanding of how Christ has assumed the totality of humanity for its salvation. At the beginning of Laws 552, Hooker cautions that in respect to the incarnation, it is not in man's ability. It is not a man's ability either to express perfectly or conceive the manner how this was brought to pass. Howbeit, because this divine mystery is more true than plain, divers, having framed the same to their own conceits and fancies, are found in their expositions thereof more plain than true. After Hooker presents one of his several summaries of the four ecumenical councils, most of this chapter, Laws 552, is given to a close examination of the error of Nestorius, introduced by a quote from Cyril's letter to Eulogius, a priest in Constantinople, letter from the mid-430s. The passage states that Nestorius errs in denying the union of natures in Christ. Hooker focuses positively on Cyril's role in identifying the Nestorian heresy condemned at Ephesus in 431. And then he goes out of his way to insist that Cyril did not hold the position that, quote, even as the body and the soul, so in Christ, God and man, they have but one nature, unquote. Hooker clearly knows that the most reoccurring image in Cyril of the union of the Godhead and humanity in Christ is precisely that of a manner of the union of the soul and body in man. In this image in particular, Cyril uses to support his strong claim that in the incarnation the eternal word suffers, and that the word's engagement in human sorrows is the supreme redemptive principle. And I think that this aspect of Cyril's thinking is embraced by Hooker and critical to his argument, and that is why Hooker insists that Cyril uses this image appropriately. The inappropriate use of the image of body and soul to suggest that there is one nature in Christ is the error of Eutyches, is at pains to emphasize. In keeping with Hooker's appropriation of Cyril's teaching that the suffering of the Word brings within the Godhead the fragile and suffering flesh for the purpose of redemption and the return of the created order to its first cause, Hooker concludes his discussion with reference to a passage from Theodoret's third dialogue. Quote, "The divine nature must be confessed inseparable from the flesh, even on the cross and in the tomb." Well, this is very surprising. Surprising passage for Hooker to quote because it appears in Theodoret's third dialogue in the Erinistes. This was written a year or two after the death of Cyril, in which, under the guise of his literary imperative, Theodoret ridicules Cyril's paradoxical turn of phrase that the Son suffered impassively. Nonetheless, because of Theodoret's continuing influence on English Eucharistic theology since Peter Martyr introduced the Erinistes to Cranmer, Hooker must show substantial agreement between Theodoret and Cyril, and this expression is the closest that Theodoret would come to Cyril's extreme language of the suffering God. I suggest that for Hooker's overall argument of how God is in Christ, how Christ is in us, and how we are partakers of Christ in the sacraments, Hooker seeks to embrace a Cyrillian Christology that allows the fullness of God's presence in the world by bringing suffering within the life of the Trinity, while at the same time denying suffering in the inner life of the Trinity. This paradoxical language is an instance, I think, where, quote, "this divine mystery is more true than plain." In Christ there is no personal, this is Hooker, in Christ there is no personal subsistence but one, and that from everlasting. By taking only the nature of man, he can still continue with one person, whereupon it followeth against Nestorius that no person was born of the Virgin but the Son of God, no person but the Son of God baptized, the Son of God condemned, the Son of God and no other person crucified. This is Hooker. Hooker concludes his discussion of the Communicatio Idiomatum in Laws 553 by pointing specifically to the 5th century Christological debate between Cyril and Theodoret over divine impassivity. So why does he go to such length to quote this and to talk about this controversy? Well, here, I'm not going to read it, I'm running short of time. Hooker is referring to Cyril's third letter to Nestorius in 430, to which were attached to 12 anathemas, and the 12th anathema pushed the limits of Trinitarian doctrine. If anyone does not confess that the Word of God suffered in the flesh, was crucified in the flesh, and tasted death in the flesh, becoming the firstborn from the dead, although as God he is life and life-giving, let him be anathema. Theodoret, representative of the Antiochene tradition, was convinced that this language violated the impassible God of Nicaea, and that Cyril allowed the human pathos of Jesus to touch the Godhead. And indeed, the entire argument of the three dialogues of Theodoret, so influential in the development of Eucharistic doctrine in England in the second half of the 16th century, this whole dialogue was to reject Cyril's notion of the impassible suffering of the Son as nonsensical. In Francis Young's phrase, Theodore accused Cyril of destroying the godness of God. Hooker knows all this. And he knows that Cyril refuses to recant. Cyril was primarily a biblical exegete. In passages like John 1:14, Hebrews 2:14, 17, and Philippians 2, all cited by Hooker in this section, Cyril read how the Son participated fully in human limitation. The biblical text spoke of a Christ who both suffered and was God. For Cyril, the Antiochian position represented by Theodoret meant that the great gulf separating God and the world had not been bridged at all. In respect to the divine mystery, Theodoret's position is more plain than true. The paradox of impassible suffering points to the soteriological purpose of the incarnation, inviting our participation in the eternal life of the triune love. The Son's suffering does not merely demonstrate God's solidarity with us. By being incarnate, the eternal Son took on a state in which he could, in some real sense, experience suffering and death. That which is not assumed is not healed, or, as Cyril says, our deification and enjoyment of the life of God requires that, quote, he took what was ours to be his very own, so that we might have all that was his. Hooker tells us in Laws 5:54, the union, therefore, of the flesh with deity is to that flesh a gift of principal grace and favor, for by virtue of this grace, man is really made God. Hooker concludes Laws 5:53 by championing both Theodoret and Cyril, allowing Hooker to embrace Theodoret as an authority, yet at the same time to affirm a Cyrillian emphasis on how Christ is in us. Concluding remarks. In these chapters, Richard Hooker shows how God is in Christ, how Christ is in us, and in subsequent chapters, he will consider how the sacraments make us partakers with Christ. We have seen that the structure of Hooker's commentary on the sacraments in the Book of Common Prayer is in keeping with the general tendency of the magisterial reformers who avoid the scholastic question of how Christ is localized in the Eucharistic elements and rather embrace the Greek patristic tradition in which the Eucharist is an anamnesis of the whole Christ event. The doctrine of the Eucharist recapitulates the doctrine of the person of Christ. Thus, for Hooker, the doctrine of the sacraments is essentially Trinitarian and Christological doctrine. Theodoret, Cyril, and John of Damascus all consider the meaning of the Eucharist itself in these passages we've been considering. In the second dialogue of Erinistes, Theodoret writes, importantly, that as the flesh assumed by the Son of God remains flesh while still deified, so likewise the bread and wine of the Eucharist retain their creaturely natures after the consecration. But I think that Hooker particularly wants to highlight Cyril's language of the Eucharist. Hooker refers several times to Cyril's third letter to Nestorius, in which his use of the expression impassible suffering is followed by a description of how communicants are sanctified by becoming participants in the holy flesh and the precious blood of Christ. Communicants receive, quote, the personal, truly vitalizing, life-giving, very flesh of God, the Word himself. And in his commentary on John's Gospel, Cyril emphasizes that Christ comes to dwell in us more and more fully as we partake of the Eucharistic flesh and blood. Significantly, when Hooker speaks powerfully of our participation also in the fruit, grace, and efficacy of his body and blood, whereupon there issueth the kind of transubstantiation in us, a true change both of soul and body, Hooker cites Cyril's commentary on John. I suggest that Hooker discovers in Cyril another sign of the 5th century Christological debates that informs and deepens the efficacy of prayer book liturgy. Cyril represents a tradition that emphasized God's intimate presence in and through creation. Is it a bridge too far to suggest that for Hooker, Theodoric was too narrow in his relentless efforts to protect the potential confusion of God and creature, that Theodoric, representative of the Antiochian position, too much emphasized otherness in regards to creation? Cyril, on the other hand, represents a tradition that stretches language to paradox and is willing to rest in the poetry of paradoxes found in Scripture, embracing the fullness of God's presence in his creation. Thus, in Cyril's hermeneutic, we find the possibility of the re-enchantment of nature. Cyril's theology is consistent with Hooker's all-embracing lex divinitatis that he inherits from Dionysius and he sums up in Laws 5:56. For Dionysius, as for Richard Hooker, the whole of the created order is theophany, both divine transcendence and divine immanence simultaneously. But equally for Hooker, in the sacramental principles drawn from scriptures interpreted by the Greek patristic tradition and expressed in the prayer book liturgy, the whole of the created order can also be described as sacramental in character. As theophany and sacrament, the goodness and integrity of the natural order is fully acknowledged, yet is not exhaustive of its meaning. The natural points to a transcendence and immanence that ultimately, in return, gives a deeper meaning and reverence to nature itself. On the one hand, the thoroughly secular students who arrive at my small liberal arts university each year typically are convinced that an objectifying and reductionist view of nature has contributed to its exploitation and destruction. On the other hand, these students reject the God of institutional Christianity that represents an unresolved separation or duality between the divine and the world. These students remain restless for a way of thinking that makes sense of their apprehension of transcendence and immanence in the natural world and in the human community. They seek to know the world as theophany, to experience the presence of the divine throughout nature. They seek to know the world as sacrament. Our return, what makes us truly human, is through the natural order, though deified, not in spite of it. And our church can help, I think, these thoroughly secular students come to know the world as theophany and as sacrament. The Anglican sacraments, as interpreted by Hooker in the light of the Greek Fathers, encourages a particular worldview, a way of seeing and interpreting the whole of experience as theophany and sacrament, making us partakers of the divine within the created order, leading us to know our happiness by living the life of God, the Holy Trinity. In the words of Thomas Traherne, next generation of Hooker, "From dust I rise and out of nothing now awake. These brighter regions which salute mine eyes, a gift from God I take, the earth, the seas, the light, the day, the skies. The sun and stars are mine, and these I prize. Long time before I in my mother's womb was born, a God preparing did this glorious store, this world for me adorn. Into this Eden, so divine and fair, so wide and bright I come, his son and heir. A stranger here, strange things doth meet, strange glories see, strange treasures lodged in this fair world appear. Strange all, and new to me, but that they mine should be. Who nothing was, that strangest is of all, yet brought them."